morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Zion Lutheran Church here in West Union this morning. There's a lot going on in our congregation and our community today. We have fellowship following worship here. But if you need a more substantial breakfast, I think you all know that the Lion's Pancake Breakfast is going on between now and 12:30 at the high school. And then this afternoon, our youth are having a car at the community trunk or treat in the courthouse square. So lots going on in our congregation and community. Alan Tupper passed last Thursday evening at Stony Brook. Visitation with the family will be tomorrow evening from 5 to 7 here at Zion. And then the funeral service will be held here at Zion at 11 o'clock on Tuesday morning, with a luncheon following, and then with burial at Oak Ridge Cemetery at 2 o'clock. The gifts of God abound here at Zion. This morning, Isaiah Stansbury will be our preacher. As I think and hope you know, Isaiah recently enrolled in studies at Wartburg Seminary. And we have not one, but two choirs this morning. Our bell choir and our senior choir are making musical offerings amongst us this morning. Please stand as you are able for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sins, gracious God. Listen when we call out to help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Sovereign God, you turn your greatness into goodness for all the peoples on earth. Shape us into willing servants of your kingdom, and make us desire always and only your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah, the 4th chapter. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgressions of my people. They made his grave with the wicked, and the tomb with the rich, although he has done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord. We will read Psalm 91 responsively. Because you have made the Lord your refuge and the Most High your habitation. For God will give the angels charge over you to guard you in all your ways. You will tread upon the lion cub and viper. You will trample down the lion and the serpent. They will call me, and I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. A reading from the book of Hebrews, the 5th chapter. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to gently with the ignorant and the wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because he must offer sacrifice for his own sins as well as those of his people, and the one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 10th chapter. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. So, I'll explain this in a moment. The last time that I was up here preaching was actually September 19th. And I asked the question, is there anything worse than a mediocre Christian? Is there anything worse than a Christian that is comfortable right where they're at? Comfortable with the gift of grace without the desire to seek repentance in Christ. Faced with the disciples arguing over who was the greatest, Jesus brought them back to focus on what is truly important. And I asked, if we have that kind of faith, that when we are met with the troubles in our lives, do we have the kind of faith built on the rock of Christ? And then I left worship that morning, and by the afternoon I was sitting in the emergency room with my son Zeke, and by the early evening I was watching him being put in the back of an ambulance and taken down to the Iowa City Children's Hospital so that they could keep him stabilized. Same day. And I thought, I know I asked the question, but I don't know if I needed to be tested on it so soon. And I prayed. I prayed for peace of mind. I prayed for Zeke's safety. I prayed so hard that he wouldn't be afraid of being alone, because neither Cassie or I could be in the back of the ambulance with him. I brought my requests to God, and he heard me, and he answered. And I have to understand that sometimes it's not just a yes or a no. Sometimes when God answers, he says, "Not yet." Or, "Just wait and see." Sometimes it's just wait. And sometimes, his answer is a bit humorous. Because irony of ironies here, we had just celebrated Cassie's 30th anniversary of being diabetic just a couple of days prior to that. And we had just talked about weathering the storms in our lives, and there we were. And there was this moment where Cassie and I looked at each other, and we just shook our heads and laughed. This is crazy. This was crazy. And we found that our son, who should have potentially been scared, was laughing a little bit too. We found God's blessings even there. We had this overwhelming sense of peace sitting next to that hospital bed. There was joy there. There was even laughter. We could find laughter everywhere. In fact, I know I've mentioned before of the humor that I have found in the Bible. The humor that is there. And I've gotten some mixed reviews about it. But it's there. It's there if you're looking hard enough at it. And this gospel lesson happens to be one of those times, or at least the lead up to the teaching moment in the gospel lesson. I can almost hear Jesus slapping his forehead at the, slapping his forehead as he gathers everybody around. At James and John's request, what are you saying? And then he says, all right, everybody's angry. Come here, just come here. Let's talk about this, okay? What were James and John thinking? What were they thinking? Now, we actually see this story show up in Matthew as well, except that it is James and John's mother who makes the request in Matthew. So it's highly likely that the Gospel of Mark was using Simon Peter's firsthand account of the gospel when they were writing the gospel. So it's safe to say that Mark's gospel is taken from Peter's point of view, and Matthew is written by Matthew's firsthand account, so it's from his point of view. But for some reason, John left this particular story out of his firsthand account. Kind of strange, don't you think, that he just failed to mention this particular story? In Mark 3:17, Jesus gives James and John the nickname Sons of Thunder. Of thunder. Because their passion and their attitude is like a storm crashing on the sea. This is actually a screenshot from season 2 of The Chosen. And I don't know if I've made it painfully obvious yet, but I love this show. My whole family loves this show. And if you haven't seen it yet, or even if you have, you know that it's very much worth watching. In fact, you have a chance to watch the very first episode of season 1 this Wednesday at Compass with the Contenders and the Warriors, our confirmation students. There are 8 episodes in the first season, and we are hopefully going to be able to work through each one over the school year, before the school year is over. But this particular scene is taken directly from Luke chapter 9, verse 54, after a particularly nasty encounter with the Samaritans. And actually, when the disciples, James and John, saw Jesus being disrespected by the Samaritans, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? Sons of thunder. Do you want us to rain down heaven? We can do it in your name. And again, Jesus slaps his forehead. What are you doing? What are you thinking? No, I don't want you to rain down fire. Are you kidding? In this gospel lesson, who do you relate to the most? James and John? The other disciples? Or Jesus? Those are our three main players there. Is James and John's request so ridiculous? Is it so far removed from what we do? At least they were honest about their request. Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you. Whatever we ask. At least they were upfront about it. Perhaps we are not so honest when we're sitting next to the hospital bed, pleading with God. Perhaps we don't think that this is exactly what we're doing and what we're asking for when we're asking for forgiveness, when we beg for God's healing of a loved one, for his protective hand to shelter our babies as they go out into the world. I do not fault James and John for this. At least they were being honest. God, this is what I want from you. And he heard them. And he answered. So let's be honest today. I can identify with James and John. Can you? I think all of us face this problem, that all of us can identify with James and John. The question is why? Why? Because this passage reveals to us the heart of idolatry. So what is idolatry? Is it literally worshiping stone statues? Well, yes, that counts. That does count. If you are bowing down to rock carvings or offering sacrifices to them, that is definitely idolatry. No question about it. But more generally, and more commonly in our day and age, idolatry is turning good things into ultimate things. Idolatry is worshiping something besides God, worshiping an idol besides God. We replace God with what we really want. And when idolatry goes unchecked, we can become so presumptuous that we even manage to work up the courage to ask God for help in us worshiping our idols. We ask God for help in worshiping our idols. We don't always go for the unconditional, whatever I want approach. Oftentimes we take a more humble approach about it, a more modest approach. We're more specific. God, I promise I'll do anything for you if you just get me this A on this test. Or, God, I know I haven't been to church in a while, but please, I need a raise at work. Or, God, I've been sacrificing everything for you. I have been at church every single week. I'm just asking for the winning lottery numbers. Is that so much to ask? Can you imagine if I did this in another context? If I went to my wife, Cassie, and I said, Cassie, I need your help. And she'd go, of course. How can I help? And I said, Cassie, I need you to help me find another wife. Chances are she would not be pleased for that. If I was looking for another wife, if I've already married. And asking my current wife to find me another wife is illogical and it's offensive, right? That is what James and John are doing here. God, can you please give me another God to worship? Myself. Now, in their request, and when they're in Matthew's version, when their mother makes this request, I believe they have good intentions. I believe their intentions are good. I want to be in your glory. I want to show you how much I worship you. But do they realize that by raising themselves up? Do their mother realize that by raising her sons up, she's diminishing God's greatness? We read the scriptures here or on our own, and at times we struggle with how this applies to our lives today. How does the Word of God, with the greater majority of it being written thousands of years ago, in a different culture, in a different language, in a different country, through a different social lens, how does this apply to my life today? Like this. Just like James and John, there are times that we are guilty of idolatry. Instead of wanting God, we want what God can give us. And sometimes we're not afraid to ask God to do our will. Maybe James and John are too direct for you. But what about the other disciples? Let's look at verse 41. When the ten heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. They were jealous. They were upset that they had not had this good idea of asking Jesus about sitting in his glory first. Or maybe they were just shocked at how brazen their request was. Maybe they were secretly thinking, if we were just able to keep our heads down and work hard, I'll bet Jesus will give us whatever I want, whatever we want. And all of a sudden, their hearts were laid bare. They wanted the same things as James and John, but they were too proud to say it. So what about us? What about you? Are you the direct type? Telling God straight up, here's what I want you to do for me. The deadline was yesterday. Or do you go the more indirect route? To outdo others in religious service, making greater sacrifices, act more obediently, be more radical, and secretly, deep down, you're hoping like crazy that God is noticing and will make your dreams come true. Whatever your strategy, don't you think, deep down, wouldn't it be great if God would do whatever I ask him to do? And here's the really important part. Here's the part that separates the disciples from Jesus, us from Jesus, from their requests and their desires, their selfishness, from Jesus' response. In his response, does he say, okay, here's the deal. You put in 3 years of blood, sweat, and tears, and I'll make sure that you have a good position in my administration. Or cast out 400 demons in my name and I'll see it to that you get a nice house. No. He says, I don't want your service. I want to serve you. There's this collision. The disciples all out of selfishness and Jesus all out of selfless service. The disciples give us whatever we want. Jesus, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Do we see how much God loves us? We come to God saying, gimme, 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 gimme. And God says, I love you more than that. The things that you want, I made them. I made them. And I can arrange that for you if we need to, if that's the right thing to do. But you need more. You need way more. You need salvation. You need rescue. You need someone to die for your sins. You need someone to die for your selfishness and for your idolatry. So here's the deal. I'm not going to give you all these small, petty things. I'm going to give you my very life. I hear you, and here is my answer. He heard them, and he loved them. Now, does he say, because you ask for so much, I'm not going to give you anything ever? Or, you've pushed too hard this time, you are no longer my disciple? Or, your request is incredibly immature and selfish, and now I am angry? No. Not at all. Instead, he does something incredible. Verse 39, and Jesus said to them, the cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism in which I am baptized, you will be baptized. Verse 45, he shares his mission statement. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. Isn't that amazing? Jesus' closest friends truly are money-grubbing, power-hungry yes-men who are trying to use Jesus to get what they really want. He hears them. And how does Jesus respond? Because again, it's not always a yes or no. Sometimes it is a just wait and see. The request was, give us whatever we want. From his own disciples, who should have known better. Didn't they understand that they were supposed to love God with all of their heart, mind, soul, and strength? Not the other way around. We are in Mark 10. For the past 9 chapters, Jesus has been showing them and teaching his disciples that following him is about service and putting yourself above others. Strike that. Other way around. Putting others above yourself. Seeing if you were paying attention. That is really, really good news. Jesus loves selfish people. He loves selfish, at times non-religious people. He loves even his own disciples when they are selfish. And he deliberately gave his life on the cross that we might be reconciled with God. Look at verse 43 with me. Jesus said to his disciples, and I believe these words apply to us as well. Whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. We are called to be changed by God's love. And then, and only then, will our hearts be changed that we might imitate Jesus. That we might become joyful and glad to serve others. Jesus is calling us to follow him, not be him. To be like him, not replace him. Today, meet Jesus. Bring yourself to him and all of your selfish wanting. Let his love overwhelm your life. And no longer seek to be served, but look to serve others. What a beautiful vision. What a loving God. He sees you. He hears you. And he will answer you. We just need to listen to him. Amen. Thank you.
Let us profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Set free from sin and death, and nourished by the word of truth, we join in prayer for all of God's creation. Holy One, for the gift of the Church handed down through the ages and for all who carry on the servant ministry of Jesus, we praise you. Send your Holy Spirit upon all who are discerning calls to ministry in its many forms and equip them with your gifts. Hear us, O God. Creating One, for the lush and abundant habitat that you provide all of your creatures, we praise you. Provide healing for the earth so that all its creatures and living things may flourish as you intend. Hear us, O God. Suffering One, for all who work toward peace and who lead nations with a servant's heart, we praise you. Bring justice for all who suffer violence, persecution, discrimination, hunger, poverty, and homelessness, and create places of refuge for all people. Hear us, O God. Merciful One, for all who do the work of healing in mind, body, and spirit, we praise you. Surround and comfort all who struggle with depression, anxiety, cancer, diabetes, dementia, or any illness. Especially we pray for Joyce, Bob, Jeanette, Roy, Julie, Colleen, Lois, John, Robert, and the family and friends of Alan, that all may be healed. Hear us, O God. Sustaining Ones, for all who volunteer for the vitality of this congregation, we praise you. Strengthen and encourage greeters, ushers, volunteers, bakers, counters, committee members, teachers, students, evangelists, singers, ringers, builders, nurturers, and all who serve with generous hearts. Hear us, O God. Confident that you hear us, O God, we boldly place our prayers into your hands. Through Jesus Christ, our truth and life. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Please share that peace with your neighbors.
Please stand as you are able. Let us pray. God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have first given us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed, and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us, and believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers with those of your servants in every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name.
Please be seated. So worshipers will proceed down the center aisle. to receive bread from me, and then to one side or the other to receive wine from a communion assistant. We'll be alternating sides. There will be an usher who will alternate rows back and forth. So we more or less have one line coming down the middle to facilitate a little distancing there. Please follow the usher's direction. Bread is gluten-free. Grape juice is a little, it looks like wine, but the grape juice is in the center of the tray if you are in need of grape juice. All who hunger and thirst, come. The table is ready.
Doug and I will each sing those parts several times. Feel free to pick a part and join us when you catch on.
Come one, come all, come one, come all.
Come to the table.
Come to the table.
Please stand as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Gracious God, loving all your family with a mother's tender care, as you sent the angel to feed Elijah with heavenly bread, assist those who set forth to share your word and sacrament with those who are sick or homebound. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those who will receive this sacrament, and give us all the comfort of your abiding presence through the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace. The living word dwells in you.